So I saw my colleague Victor do this once. I'm just inspired by Victor Castro in one of his presentations. I thought I should be doing it. Okay. Let's go ahead. So the first question, when you install I2B2 for the first time, how long did it take? Did it take, never tried, few minutes, few hours, few days, few weeks, few months, few years, or you never succeeded at all? For me, it was a few years. I tried installing it when I, you know, was doing my PhD program in computer and scientific computing, and it was just too heavy for me to do it. So I waited for almost 5 years until I became a postdoc, and then I was able to try again. And it took me several months to install it. Right. And over the years, I felt I2B2 has got such an amazing conceptualization to offer. It can benefit a lot of research. But how to make it available for people who are not so much code savvy, or how to make it available for clinicians or researchers? How can I2B2 help development of apps, you know, in practice, development of applications? So this is the question that we have been, the path we have been on. Okay. Have you heard of I2B2 Docker? So when I first joined Sean 4 years ago, 5 years ago, it took me 3 months to install I2B2, and I was sitting right next to Mike Mendes and others. It still took me a while, partly because I was a bit lazy, but that inspired me to go ahead and write code which others could use, and over a period of time with others, with Sean's input and with others, it evolved into I2B2 Docker, and we've got a couple of papers out there, and we've got some people from the community participating in evaluating Docker, and we are really looking at building applications in the clinical practice so that I2B2 can be up and available in a few seconds. I'm going to show you a demo. Sorry, before I do that. So all you need to use I2B2 Docker is to create a container having a create a virtual machine having Docker. And you'll find that those steps online in the I2B2 Quick Start documentation. Once you have that, it just requires you just need to clone the repository, and you'll have the code. And you just need to run this one line, Docker Compose up, and you put in the three containers, the Postgres, Wildfly, and Web, and you'll have your I2B2 on your VM, on your instance in less than 60 seconds. Looks like this. You can see it. So in this instance, the container is already there. If they are not there for the first time, it will connect to Docker Hub and pull them down. So you can try this at home. And to check that it's up there. You can go to your local host web client and you can run the query. Okay, and you can tear it down and put it up again and play around with the data. So this is like the biggest hurdle in getting people to use I2B2. So when that's out of the way, what next? How am I going to load data into this? And so the ETL, there's a lot of work going on, but it's complicated. You really, there's a very deep learning curve to understand all the schemas and all the tables, right? So we looked at, can it be simplified? Okay, let me just take a step back and look at the bigger picture here. Okay, now we are looking at using I2B2 to facilitate rapid development of health ID applications. Okay. And what is the challenge right now? What is the challenge in developing health ID applications or any developing any application in the clinic? There is a wide gap between what the clinician thinks in his head, what he conceptualizes about the EHR, and what is available for the developers to work with. You know, there's a gap between how people think about it and how the data is stored and transmitted. So while the developers all the while work with the EHR view of the data, clinicians have another view, right? And we need to bridge that gap. So there are three principles, which I think are the three principles. So one is that the data is stored in a particular format, you know, and then there are schemas, you know, and FHIR is trying to, you know, address that. Second thing, it's stored using proprietary coding systems, right? So it's about, and you require a mapping from the local coding system to a standard coding system. And thirdly, I think we need to talk more about this in the literature, is about that clinicians combine multiple data elements in their head when they think of data. Like, for example, BMI, ACB score, like, you know, last LDL. So these are, there is some computation involved. It's not immediate, you know, it's not the raw data. So we need to have a way to represent that to help this conversation to happen. Okay. So we proposed a semantic framework. This is what this line means. A semantic framework for abstracting EHR data using I2B2. Okay. I'm going to talk about this in the background of a project we are doing in the clinic at Brigham and Women's, in which we want to identify, we want to stand up AI system to help navigators treat cardiovascular patients in a particular way, right? And we're making apps for that. The first challenge people have about dealing with data is that programmers go and make schemas for everything. And whenever someone new comes, it takes months to understand what schema was. And I2B2 helps amazingly in this way, because there is just a big long fact table, and, you know, essentially there's a concept table and a fact table. And it's very intuitive. If you don't, it's a denormalized format. It's very intuitive and easy to work with, right? So that helps challenge one. Like, you know, you're really not wasting your time developing, you know, all these tables. So this is coming towards data import, right? We wanted to work out a way to make it simple to import data. So all we said is that let the EHR data be in this fact-like.csv file. And you can see that there is a institutional code for every entry. It doesn't map to a standard code. And we had the clinicians or the knowledge engineers come up with a simple concept definition. Okay, you call a concept. You can use a path to give like a semantic context to that concept, and you just specify whether it's a numerical concept or a textual concept, right? And we wrote code to take the CSV file in and create the I2B2 ontology, which you see on the left. But it is still not connected to the fact table, right? So that you require a concept mapping table, and you'll find that. So you could, you know, EHR vendors do this. Whenever they come and install a product, they spend a lot of time building these mappings, right? So a concept like LDL, last LDL, has got like 600 different codes. So this mapping table would help you do that. And working with persistent, we have written code by which, if you have these three files, it'll load it into I2B2 and it'll be available. Okay, I'm not going to run this demo here right now because it's not working. I was not able to debug it. But that's where it'll take you, that you can, you know, have people simplify come up with simplistic representation of data and populate that in, use I2B2 for that. Import that into I2B2. Okay. At the bottom, actually, there are a lot of stuff I want to cover, but I'm going to be very superficial, right? So I'm going to go very, give you a bird's eye view. So I'm going to talk about I2B2 in the cloud, how and the Docker Compose helps you run it in the cloud. And we have installed it in the production environment right now in partners, and we're really evaluating it to see how we can build apps of I2B2. Batch ontology creation and import, which is a module which I just showed to you. Derived data. I'm going to talk about what is derived data. Spreadsheet imports, REST API, real-time sync. I2B2 is not really in sync. It runs many days or weeks behind clinical data. So we can't really use it for clinical applications, for a lot of the clinical applications, and then machine learning. Okay. So what are derived variables? A concept like is alive, has hypertension, last LDL, max LDL. These are all concepts in the clinician's head. There is no data point for it. Okay. So can you put in code or logic into I2B2? I2B2 traditionally holds data, but can you insert in code by which these facts are automatically computed and available downstream so that programmers don't need to reinvent this again, right? So that this is an exercise which we have tried for our project. We created this new cell derived concept definition, NH, and it takes in a blob of SQL statement. You define a concept, and what happens is when you load data, it triggers the execution of derived concepts, and those are available as first class facts. We are right now working with embedding SQL code, but we don't see a problem. Maybe it'll cover 95% of the use cases, but this could be a way to embed machine learning models. It could be a way of embedding Python code, other things. So we are thinking about it in a generic sense. So that's a derived data module. So essentially, we want to simplify use of I2B2 to just populating these four tables: fact table, concept mapping table, and derived concept definitions. You can read the paper about it. This is like the big picture about how you can have, so on the right, messages streaming in, they're stored into I2B2, and then you've got this layer, which is semantic layer, which is not institution specific, but can be tied to an institution by the local to standard code mapping, and then it feeds apps running on top. Here is the entire workflow. It's published in this paper. Entire workflow by which non-clinical, non-IT clinical experts can participate in creating micro projects for I2B2. Like I2B2 typically be used for running at the institutional level, but can it help a particular application? Let's say like the one I described. So that's what we are tackling over here, and that's what Persistent is partnering with us for, creating micro I2B2 projects. Use cases are like finding patients for care coordination, supporting, you got an app and you want to record data, and you want to store it in some place before it goes into the EHR, those kind of things. And the REST API, right? So instead of having people make the CSV files, can we in real time push information into I2B2? We just made a blueprint, and this is a very initial version of it. Spreadsheets. Brisket has a project in which you can import spreadsheets into I2B2. There are many researchers who have got very long spreadsheets, a lot of data, and it doesn't open in Excel. And you have to use R or something else to process it. Importing it into I2B2, it's very intuitive to query that data, right? So people have, and there are projects existing for that. So we've tried to develop a tool for that. Okay, and we have a I2B2 Fire API 2 years ago, proof of concept. We're working on I2B2 real-time sync. I2B2 for machine learning, there are two things involved: transforming I2B2 table into a feature matrix, and then second part is actually deploying ML models using the derived fact table, which I showed to you. Okay, let me go back to my survey. Will you use I2B2 in the cloud before I go ahead? Do you see your institution deploying this code? People are skeptical. They are. Okay, thanks. So here is some guidance which I want from you for this roadmap that we're working with Persistent, right? So I described to you several innovations on the I2B2 platform. It's so can you go ahead and rate it? For each innovation, I2B2 in the cloud, batch import, spreadsheet, how important is it for you and how urgent it is for you? That'll kind of help us prioritize the development and release of this app in open source. So cloud is I2B2, Docker. Batch import is importing data from CSV files, bulk import, ETL. Spreadsheet is importing data from spreadsheet into I2B2. REST API is the real-time JSON API. Derived facts is embedding logic into I2B2. A real-time synchronization that's going to require some work, and then machine learning. So REST API is coming up as urgent, which we thought it would be. There are many people who would be able to use I2B2 in that particular way. Real-time synchronization is coming to be urgent, but I'm surprised that people don't find it to be important. Well, I think these things are important because if you want to do these things and go to your IT department, you'll be put on a waiting list. So if we don't do this, and if we don't use I2B2 to enable this innovation, then it's not going to happen. It's going to take a long time to happen. Okay, I'm going to stop here and open it out for questions. I want to acknowledge a whole lot of projects and people who are contributing and touch this piece of work. Mainly want to acknowledge the work from Sandy's team and Hallam's team from BWH, and where we are really trying these. We're developing this code for I2B2 and testing it in the real world. I want to stop here and open up for questions. Yuri, you want to join me?
Sure.
Zach's not here to ask questions. Yeah? Go ahead.
On your I2B2 Docker instance, is that installing a database?
Yes. Yes.
Is that connecting to the
external? No, it's loading the database.
So it's building a database.
It's building and loading a database. So going back to this slide. So it's creating three containers. It's creating the web container, the Wildfly container, and the Postgres container. And it's the Postgres container has the preloaded data, which is already there in Docker Hub. So it just pulls it down and spawns it up. So that's why it's able to do it in it's an image of the database. You can load it in the 30 seconds. Otherwise, it's going to take half an hour to run the script and load the data.
Okay. Excellent.
Can you say that again?
You said like the observation flag people have created. You have application,
Yeah, I'll repeat the question. So she's referring to you know, this, like, you know, how are we do you, she's asking, do you have applications which are already working with your simplified versions of the tables, right? Yeah, so we don't have applications working, but we're in the process of making that happen. You know, our challenge is to make it easy for programmers in our project to put data from the EHR into I2B2, right? And for them, it takes a long time to understand how I2B2 is organized. So we're coming up with this very simple form of tables. If you can store data in that way, our code will take it and put it for you into I2B2. And this is evolving towards a real-time API. So we would just have programmers, instead of creating these files, they could directly make the JSON REST calls to I2B2. And the data would go back in. So you don't need to understand all you know, all the internals of I2B2. All you need to think is, okay, what is a concept and what is a fact? And there are very simple definitions for it. Three columns for what is a concept, three elements, and five elements for define what is a fact.
I might just add to that. So one of the use cases that we're considering, it's a very significant use case that we inherited. And it already had its own data model. And what we've been discovering is that the mapping is not entirely straightforward, but the reason it's not entirely straightforward is because the original developers of the application did not think of things in the ontology model that I2B2 encourages. And so that, as a result, has caused them a lot of problems in reporting and making use of the data outside of this project. So one of the reasons, one of the impetuses actually for creating this project was to get people to think about data in this way so that ultimately you put your ontologies first and you don't get a bunch of junk data at the end of your clinical application. And so it's a challenge, but a very important one, that there are a lot of reasons to start thinking of data in this way at the clinical application level.
Yeah, we have been really in this community using I2B2 in this particular way, and a lot of learning, we went through a lot of learning to understand all these things, but how do we open it out to others? Make it very simple, even for ourselves. Any other question? Thank you.